Hey, long time no see. Dr. Asra Basunia here. Welcome to one of my most ambitious projects to date. Biostatistics and epidemiology are important subjects tested in all three USMLE exams. In this video series, I'm going to broadly cover almost every biostatistics and epidemiology topic on the USMLE syllabus. Where relevant, I will walk you through sample problems and describe a few nifty mnemonics. I hope these lessons serve as a comprehensive introduction before you tackle your question banks. Please check out the description below for a list of topics I will discuss in this module. USMLE Biostatistics, a complete review. Hello, this is me on the day of my medical school graduation just a few months ago. You can follow me on Twitter at AsfarBasunia, and you can follow me on my YouTube channel where I post all of my educational content. The topics that I'm going to cover on biostatistics, epidemiology, and population health are found on the USMLE content outline on pages 27 and 28. Our first module is going to be on epidemiology and population health. Let's start by talking about prevalence. Prevalence is defined as the disease frequency or burden of disease at a specific time point. We calculate prevalence by dividing the total number of cases at the time point by the total population at that time point. And prevalence broadly calculates the pretest probability of a disease, and it is directly related to the positive predictive value and inversely related to the negative predictive value. We will learn how to calculate the positive and negative predictive values in a future video. Now, incidence measures the risk of disease. It is broadly defined as the proportion of at-risk disease-free population that develops the disease over a defined time period. So we calculate incidence by dividing the total number of new cases over a time period by the total population of at-risk individuals at the start of the time period. Now, population at risk includes individuals who can develop the disease. So this excludes individuals who already have the disease, as well as individuals who won't be defined by the disease. So for instance, if we are looking at sudden infant death syndrome or SIDS, children who are greater than 1 year old are not at risk because they are not considered infants. When we talk about incidence, it's also known as cumulative incidence. Another way of looking at incidence is through incidence rate, which accounts for when the disease occurs, a dynamic population, that is individuals moving in and out of the population, as well as accounts for losses to follow up. It is calculated by dividing the total number of new cases during the observation period by the total person time of observation while at risk during the study. The total person time is calculated by adding the time of observation of each individual included in the study, and those individuals need to be at risk. So the convention for expressing person time is per person years or per 10 person years, 100 person years, or 1,000 person years. Some important relationships between incidence and prevalence to keep in mind. For chronic diseases like diabetes or hypertension, the prevalence is usually greater than the incidence. This is because of increased survival or improved quality of care in the management of these chronic diseases. For acute or short-lasting diseases, most likely infectious diseases like sepsis or flu, the prevalence is almost equivalent to the incidence. This is because of either increased mortality rates, such as from sepsis, or faster healing time, such as with the flu. Now, vaccination decreases both the incidence of the disease as well as the prevalence of the disease.
So let's run through a quick example of incidence and prevalence. Suppose we have a rural community with a population of 10,000 people, among whom 5,000 have type 2 diabetes at the end of 2019. We have 100 new cases of type 2 diabetes that arose between 2019 and 2020, and in the same one-year interval, around 50 people passed away from complications of type 2 diabetes. The first question asks us to calculate the prevalence of type 2 diabetes at the end of 2019. Now remember, the prevalence is given by the total number of cases of the time point divided by the total population at that time point. So in this case, at the end of 2019, we have 5,000 individuals with type 2 diabetes. divided by the total population at the end of 2019, which is around 10,000 people. So 5,000 divided by 10,000, which is 0.5 or 51%. The next question asks us to calculate the prevalence of type 2 diabetes at the end of 2020. Now, the total number of cases of type 2 diabetes at the end of 2020 is given by the 5,000 individuals plus the 100 new cases minus the 50 individuals who passed away, divided by the total population at the end of 2020, which is 10,000 individuals minus the 50 individuals who passed away. So the prevalence of type 2 diabetes at the end of 2020 is 5,050 divided by 9,950, which is equal to 0.51 or 51%. Thus, the prevalence actually went up in 2020 compared to 2019 of type 2 diabetes. The last question asks us to calculate the incidence of type 2 diabetes between 2019 and 2020, which is given by the total number of new cases of type 2 diabetes in the time interval divided by the total population of individuals at risk of developing the disease in the beginning of the time interval. So the number of new cases of type 2 diabetes between 2019 and 2020 was 100. So we have 100 in the numerator divided by the total number of individuals at risk of developing the type 2 diabetes. So that is calculated by the taking the total population, which is 10,000 people, minus the already existing cases of type 2 diabetes, which is 5,000 people. So 10,000 minus 5,000 gives us 5,000 in the denominator. Now note that I am assuming that all 5,000 remaining people who were not already cases of type 2 diabetes were at risk of developing type 2 diabetes. So if we do 100 divided by 5,000, that gives us 0.02, which is equal to 2%. Moving on to measures of health status, first we have mortality, which is defined by the total number of deaths in a population within a time interval. Then we have morbidity, which is defined by the number of persons in a population with the disease at a specific time point. Breaking down mortality further, first let's talk about maternal mortality, which is defined by the total number of maternal deaths over the total number of live births that happened in 1 year. So the maternal deaths is defined by the death of a pregnant woman or death of a woman within 42 days of birth or pregnancy termination. Next, we have various types of children's mortality. So first we have neonatal mortality, which is defined by the total number of infant deaths within the first 28 days of life over the total number of live births in 1 year. Then we have infant mortality, which is defined by the total number of infant deaths within the first year of life over the total number of live births in 1 year. And lastly, we have under 5 mortality, which is defined by the total number of children's deaths within the first 5 years of life over the total number of live births in 1 year. Next, let's talk about crude and adjusted mortality rates. The crude rate is defined by the total number of cases at a given time point divided by the total number of persons in the population. The crude rate is expressed as per 100, per 1,000, per 10,000, etc. The important distinction between the crude and adjusted mortality rate is that the crude rate does not account for or adjusts for confounding. Now, confounding are factors that are associated with both the exposure and the disease that can potentially explain the relationship between the exposure and the disease and thus distort the results of the study. Frequently, demographic factors such as age and sex are common confounders. We will talk more about confounders in a future video. As an example, first let's take town A that has a population of 50,000 and where we have 3,000 deaths per year. The crude mortality rate will be given by 3,000 divided by 50,000, which is about 60 people per year. Now contrast that with town B, which is a population of 58,750 people and with deaths of about 4,100 per year. Thus the crude mortality rate for town B will be 4,100 divided by 58,700 and 50, which will come to about 70 per 1,000 people. Now, is the mortality rate of town B higher than that of town A because of some disease process that's going on? Or is it because of a skewed age distribution that is distorting the crude rates of town B and town A? Now, adjusted rates adjusts for possible confounding such as age and allows for better comparisons. So from the previous example of town A and town B, if we break down the mortality rates by age-specific mortality rates, where we have two different age groups, the folks who are less than 65 years old and the elderly folks who are over 65 years old. Now in town A, we have a 50-50 split, and thus 25,000 people of town A are less than or equal to 65 years, and 25,000 people are greater than 65 years. And the deaths we can see is higher in the elderly population compared to the younger population, which brings the age-specific mortality rate of town A for the younger folks at 40 per 1,000 and for the elderly folks at 80 per 1,000. Looking at the same age-specific breakdown of town B, we can see that town B has significantly more elderly population, 43,750, which represents about 3/4 of town B's total population. Whereas the younger folks who are less than or equal to 65 years old only represent about 1/4 of town B's population. And the death rates of the younger and the older folks are similar to that of town A. So in this case, if we go back to the previous example, town B has a higher crude mortality rate because the age distribution was skewing or confounding the results, which became more apparent when we adjusted for age. Moving on to standardization. Standardization is the adjustment of rates that take into account vital differences between populations, most typically age, as we saw from the previous example of town A and town B. Here, a standard age distribution, such as the population distribution of the entire United States by group, is applied to the population of interest. This allows us to directly compare the health outcomes of the different populations of interest. So commonly, we standardize by birth rates, we can standardize death rates, we can also standardize by unemployment rates when we compare these different rates of various populations, towns, counties, states, or municipalities. As an example, standardization by age-specific mortality rates allows us to compare mortality rates among various US states. The case fatality rate is defined by the proportion of patients with a particular disease or condition who dies from the complications of the disease or condition. Now, the case fatality rate must be distinguished from the mortality rate. The mortality rate is more analogous to the risk of dying from a disease or condition in the general population itself. As an example, if 10% of patients with diabetic nephropathy eventually go on to develop renal failure, but 75% of patients with renal failure complications die from it. And so the case fatality rate of renal failure among diabetic nephropathy is 75%. Life expectancy is defined by the average number of years an individual is expected to live based on the current death rates. Usually, we account for social group, geographic region, sex, year of birth, etc. Now, health-adjusted life expectancy are the average number of years an individual can expect to live in full health after adjusting for years lived in poor health due to disease or injury. A risk factor is basically in any attribute that increases the probability of disease. A very simplistic example is smoking as a risk factor for lung cancer. We also have population attributable risk as well as population attributable risk percentage on the syllabus, which will be discussed later in my module on measures of association. Latency is defined by the time between the inciting pathologic events or exposure to the disease manifestation itself or the development of clinical signs and symptoms. So in this case, if we have the inciting event here and at this time point, the disease signs and symptoms develop, this time period between the inciting pathologic events and the initial manifestation of the symptoms is defined as the latency period. Now, latency period can apply to both risk factors as well as risk reducers. As an example to risk factors, bacterial infections often have short latency periods, whereas chronic diseases like hypertension, diabetes, and HIV have long latency periods. As an example for risk reducers, lung healing after smoking cessation in chronic smokers may take years and they may not fully return to baseline functioning. Let's discuss the very important topic of survival analysis, starting with Kaplan-Meier curves. The Kaplan-Meier curves measure disease prognosis or time-to-event analysis. To illustrate with an example, here are two Kaplan-Meier curves from my own research project looking into survival by RAS pathway mutations in metastatic colorectal cancer patients. The y-axis denotes the estimated probability of event-free survival, while the x-axis notes time to follow up since entry into the study. Different patients can have different entry points into the study. When a patient enters the study, their time point is zero. Now, each vertical step or drop, such as one marked by the green box here, denotes an event of interest, which in this case is death. The probability of survival is calculated based on the proportion of patients who are alive or at risk of the event of interest. As the study progresses and events occur, the proportion of patients who are still at risk of the event decreases, which is denoted by these vertical drops as the events occur. Now, the small vertical lines, such as those marked by the blue box here, represent censoring, that is, those patients who are lost to follow-up or those who may have dropped out of the study. Censored participants are no longer considered at risk. For USMLE exams, it is important to know how to make simple inferences from Kaplan-Meier curves. A question may ask us to estimate median survival from the Kaplan-Meier curves. The median survival is denoted when the person surviving is about 50%. So in this case, what we would do is we would draw a horizontal line at 50% to the respective Kaplan-Meier curves and note the corresponding time points. In my example, the median survival in the RAS altered patients is around 28 months, whereas the median survival for RAS wild type patients is around 115 months. We may also get questions where they ask us to calculate the percentage survival or survival at a given time point. In this case, I'm using the example of 36 months. What we would do is we would draw a vertical line at 36 months to the respective Kaplan-Meier curves and then note the person survival. In my example, the person survival for RAS altered patients is around 46%, whereas the person survival at 36 months for my RAS wild type patients is around 75%. Very importantly, the log rank test is a statistical test that allows us to compare survival curves. It allows us to ask the question, is the difference that we are seeing between these two Kaplan-Meier curves statistically significant, or can the difference be explained by random noise? If the p-value is less than 0.05, the survival difference between the two groups is statistically significant, whereas if the p-value is greater than 0.05, the survival between the two groups is not significantly different. In this case, the p-value of the log rank test is less than 0.05, and thus the survival difference between the RAS altered and the RAS wild type patients is statistically significant. On the section of health status indicators, first, let's talk about quality adjusted life years, or QALYs, QALYs measure the burden of disease. More importantly, QALYs are primarily used to measure the economic impact of interventions on populations. The time trade-off, or TTO, is a tool that we use for QALY calculations. So basically, 1 year on healthy life is equal to one TTO, and 1 year of life in disability is equal to a TTO between 0 and 1. It's important to know that interventions are generally aimed at maximizing QALYs. As an example for calculating QALY, we have a 40-year-old patient who was previously healthy until age 30 and has a history of meningitis at age 30 and suffered a subsequent stroke and right-sided hemiparesis. For him, every 5 years of his life in current state is equal to 1 year of life in full health. So his TTO per year after disability is equal to 1/5 or over 0.2. He lived 30 years in TTO of 1 and 10 years in TTO of 0.2. So calculate his QALY, we do 30 times 1 plus 10 times TTO of 0.2, add them up and we get 32. It is very important to note that the formulas for QALYs will differ for populations. Thus, for the USMLEs, focus on understanding when QALYs are utilized and the fact that they use TTO as a tool for calculation. Moving on to years of potential life lost, or YPLL. YPLL measure premature mortality based on standard age-based tables of life expectancy. They're basically calculated by doing a sum of years of life lost annually by persons who suffered death prior to reaching their life expectancy. As an example, if we have four people, A, B, C, and D, who died at the ages of 70, 50, 10, and 90 years of age respectively in a small rural community in the year 2019. Now, life expectancy of the town is about 75 years of age. To calculate the YPLL of the community, we would just add up the individual YPLLs of the folks A, B, C, and D who died in the year 2019. So in this case, the YPLL of the individuals will be calculated by taking the life expectancy and subtracting the age at which they died. So for A, the YPLL will be 75 minus 70, or 5 years. For B, it will be 75 minus 50, or 25 years. For C, it is 75 minus 10, so that's 65 years. Now, for D, since D died after the age of life expectancy, their YPLL is zero. YPLL does not go negative. If YPLL for any individuals who die after life expectancy is zero. So the YPLL of the rural community itself is the summation of the individual YPLLs. So that would be 5 plus 25 plus 65 plus 0, or 95 person years. Disability adjusted life years, or DALYs, are used to compare the overall health and life expectancy among countries. They represent the difference between the current health situation and ideal living in perfect health up to the standard life expectancy. So they are primarily based on premature mortality denoted by YPLL that we just learned in the previous slide, and the burden of living with a disease or disability per year, which is measured by years lived in disability, or YLD. Now, it is very important to note that interventions are usually aimed at minimizing DALYs. As an example, to calculate DALYs, we have a previously healthy male who develops type 2 diabetes at age 30 and passes away from the complications of diabetes, in this case an MI, at the age of 60. So the standard life expectancy, for example, for him is around 75, and the disability weight for type 2 diabetes is around 0.5. Now, all of these numbers are obviously hypothetical. So YPLL for him, 75, which is the life expectancy, minus 60, which is when the patient died, so that is equal to 15 years. Now, to calculate the YLD, we basically take the years that the patient lived in disability and multiply it by the disability weight. So in this case, the patient developed diabetes at age 30 and lived until the age of 60 with diabetes. Thus, the number of years in which they lived with diabetes is around 30. That is multiplied by the disability weight for type 2 diabetes, which is around 0.5 from our prompt. So that's 30 times 0.5, that is equal to 15 years. So this patient's DALY will be equal to YPLL plus YLD, so that is 15 plus the 15 from YLD, and that will be equal to 30 years. Again, it is very important to note, just like QALYs, the formulas for DALYs will differ for different populations. And so for the purposes of USMLE, focus on broadly understanding when DALYs are utilized rather than memorizing the individual formulas. The standardized mortality ratio, or SMR, is primarily used in occupational epidemiology. It is calculated by dividing the observed deaths in the study group over the expected deaths in the study group. So the expected deaths are based on the age-specific mortality rates among the general US population. To interpret SMR, if SMR is greater than 1, this indicates that we have greater deaths among the study group compared to the general US population, which is denoting the expected deaths. So for example, if SMR is equal to 2, this indicates 2 times more deaths among the study population compared to the US population. Conversely, if SMR is less than 1, this indicates fewer deaths among the study group compared to the general US population. If SMR is equal to 1, this indicates the observed deaths and the expected deaths are approximately equal, and this is considered the null value. Standardized incidence ratio, or SIR, is used in cancer epidemiology to compare the incidence of cancer in a smaller population compared to a larger control population. SIR is calculated by dividing the observed cases in the target population over the expected cases in the larger control population. The expected cases are based on age and sex-specific incidence rates among the population of, for example, a state or even the general US population. The interpretation of SIR is very similar to that of SMR. So if SIR is equal to 1, this indicates the incidence in the target population compared to the control population are similar. If SIR is greater than 1, the incidence is larger in the target population. If SIR is less than 1, the incidence is smaller in the target population. Moving on to population pyramids, a population pyramid allows us to see the distribution of a population by sex and age groups. So here's an example of a population pyramid from Libya in the year 2011. The y-axis denotes the age group, where the higher age groups are higher up on the y-axis. The x-axis denotes the frequency, or the number, in this case, the population by thousands. And the population pyramids are separated by sex. So we have male on the left side in this case and female on the right side. There are 3 important types of population pyramids to keep in mind. The first are the expansive population pyramids, where we have higher percentage of youthful population. So the population bars for the lower age groups is going to be wider than the population bars at the top of the age group. So this happens because we have high birth rates and low life expectancy. A constrictive population pyramid happens when we have the higher percentage of the elderly population. So in this case, the bars at the more advanced age groups is going to be wider than some of the younger age groups. This happens when we have low birth rate and high life expectancy. And lastly, a stationary population pyramid is where the age and sex distribution remain stationary or constant over time. So in this case, the width of the bars across all of the age groups will approximately be similar. And this happens when the birth rate and the death rate are approximately equal. Moving right along to the section on disease surveillance and outbreak investigation. So disease surveillance refers to the monitoring the spread of a disease in order to establish patterns of progression of the disease. Disease reporting is a cornerstone of disease surveillance, where formal reporting of notifiable infectious diseases are required by healthcare workers. There are around 80 reportable diseases in the United States. This range from COVID-19, tuberculosis, anthrax, rabies, chlamydia, gonorrhea, HIV, measles, mumps, and rubella. A full list of these infectious diseases can be found on the CDC website, noted here. Very importantly, from a public health perspective, the incidence of these diseases can be a marker or indicator of the overall health of the population. Public health advisors are public health workers doing field work or contact epidemiology. They're involved in contacting, interviewing, and locating people who may have been exposed to an infectious agent, and they offer treatment and follow-up options. They're often called upon to respond to a public health or humanitarian crisis. Health promotion are public policies to address health determinants such as income, housing, food security, employment, and working conditions. Two examples of health promotion include health literacy curriculums in schools or breastfeeding promotion in clinics. A cluster is an unusually large aggregate of a medical condition, disease, or event within a particular geographic location. In this map of the United States from September 13, 2021, we're looking at new COVID-19 cases by counties. The darker the shade of red, the larger the density of cases. And note that there is a larger density of cases in the southern parts of the United States, let's say compared to the Northeast, which is concordant to what we have been seeing recently. Now, if clusters of sufficient size or importance are identified, they can be reevaluated as outbreaks. So in this case, we may note that there have been a larger outbreak of COVID-19 cases in the South compared to the Northeast. An attack rate is basically the cumulative incidence of disease, especially in the setting of an outbreak. So remember, the cumulative incidence is calculated as the proportion of people with the disease divided by the total population at risk within a time interval. So for example, in 1 year, if we have 100 new cases of cholera in a rural village with a population of 8,000, the attack rate of cholera will be the 100 new cases over the population at risk, which is 8,000, which is equal to 0.0125 or 1.25% per year, assuming that every single person in the village is at risk of getting cholera. Herd immunity refers to the concept of indirect protection from infectious diseases when a certain percentage of population becomes immune to the infection. Now, this immunity can be achieved either through vaccination or natural infection. This reduces the likelihood of transmission of infection to unvaccinated individuals. The threshold for herd immunity varies by the infectivity of the pathogen. So for pertussis, the threshold is lower at 82%, whereas for highly infectious disease vectors such as measles, the herd immunity threshold is at 95%. The last section of our first module deals with points of intervention. So in preventative medicine, first we have primordial prevention, where we address the risk factors themselves, which include environmental, socioeconomic, as well as behavioral risk factors. As an example of primordial prevention, encouraging healthy lifestyle and diet to prevent obesity, diabetes, and hypertension, all three of which are risk factors for cardiovascular disease. Now, with primary intervention, we're trying to prevent the disease occurrence itself. So primary interventions importantly decreases both the incidence and the prevalence of disease. An important example of primary prevention is vaccinations. Another important example is folate supplementation in pregnant women to prevent neural tube defects in their subsequent children. Secondary preventions target the disease early in its course to promote early intervention, prevent disease progression, and irreversible damage. Screening and their follow-up management are very important examples of secondary preventions. So some examples of screening include cardiovascular screening, such as looking at the patient's blood pressure and their lipid panel, as well as certain cancer screenings, such as colonoscopy for colon cancer and mammograms for breast cancer. In tertiary prevention, the goal is to limit impairments and disability from a disease that has already progressed to its advanced stages. Importantly, our aim is to decrease the morbidity and mortality after the disease onset. An example of tertiary prevention includes stroke rehabilitation programs after an acute stroke, tamoxifen therapy in patients with breast cancer to reduce the recurrence of the cancer. Quaternary prevention deals with limiting unnecessary or excessive interventions by a health system that could be harming more than benefiting the patients. Two important examples include avoiding CT scan in infants unless absolutely necessary, and avoiding prescribing of antibiotics when a viral disease is more likely. For community-level interventions, two important broad categories include taxation and smoke-free zones. Examples of taxation include tobacco taxes and soda taxes, where excising taxes on tobacco products or sugary drinks with the goal of discouraging purchase and thereby reducing consumption. These are examples of primordial and primary prevention. Smoke-free zones, such as smoke-free cities, buildings, restaurants, and public places, prevent harm from secondhand smoke exposure. With secondhand smoke exposure, there is increased risk of lung cancer, emphysema, bronchitis, as well as cardiovascular diseases. And again, these are also examples of primordial and primary prevention. In children, school policies such as school-based health and nutrition services promote early detection, correction, and prevention of diseases and disability in children. Three important examples include safe sex education, healthy lunches in the school cafeteria, as well as the presence of a school nurse. Now, all of these policies can have broader positive impacts in the children's families and, by extension, the communities. Lastly, let's discuss the social determinants of health. The social determinants of health are economic and social factors that influence both individual and group level differences in health status, risk of disease, or vulnerability to injury. Some important examples of social determinants of health include access to education, income distribution, working conditions, access to healthy food and clean water, housing, having safe environments, as well as a person's gender, age, and disability. Three possible interventions targeting the social determinants of health include in the realm of education, where having adequate teacher-to-student ratio will be important, as well as promoting a health-based curriculum in the school. In terms of urban development, having affordable housing, removal of lead-based paint from older houses, having parks and reliable public transportation are important. Lastly, from a public policy perspective, laws that address social determinants of health, such as the Americans with Disabilities Act or the ADA, which prohibited discrimination based on disability, the Affordable Care Act or the ACA, which expands Medicaid eligibility, and changes in individual insurance markets to promote healthcare coverage of uninsured or underinsured individuals, the Family and Medical Leave Act or FMLA, which provide employees with job protected leave for qualified medical and family reasons, as well as the previously discussed smoking ban and smoke-free zones, such as the smoking ban inside restaurants.
You have reached the end of this module. Thank you so much for bearing with me. Stay well and see you in the next module.